All right, now let's look at this as a formal argument. So we're taking the logical problem of evil, but we're going to present it as an argument. We're going to take Epicurus, and we're going to try to run through whether this classical understanding of God is right. So if God exists, then God's got these attributes. God's got to be all-knowing, all-powerful, and all-good. So if God exists, then God's got to have these abilities, this good character, and knowledge. Now, if God is omniscient, then God would know about any evil that's out there, and would also know the further thing, like how to prevent it, how to prevent any evil, like would know how to stop evil. He would know about it. He would know how to. He would have the wisdom to peer into it. But God, if God is omnipotent, then God could prevent any and all evil. We mean something like he could stop somebody like from pulling a trigger on their gun. He would stop a hurricane. He would stop any and every instance of evil. God could prevent it, and there's not any specific evil that he would be unable to stop. Even if it means causing a gun to stop working right as the trigger is about to be pulled. God could just do that. So if God is omnibenevolent, then God would choose to prevent all evil. If God is all good, there isn't a little bit of evil that he would say, oh yeah, that's fine. God would choose to prevent any and all evil. There isn't some evil that God would just be like, that's compatible with me. All evil would be something that's opposed to God in a very fundamental way. If God's all good, then any little bit of evil is a direct opposition to who God is or what God's about. So we've got this understanding then. If God's omniscient, omnipotent, and omnibenevolent, there's all these different implications. However, this seems true. God doesn't prevent all evil. God does not prevent all evil. Let's motivate this. Let's motivate this idea that God does not prevent all evil. If you can think of the last week something that you did wrong that was immoral, whether it's like talking down your coworkers or classmates, or if it's like, leaving a bad review just because you didn't get like such service that you thought you were entitled to when really they were fine. Or let's ramp it up. Let's ramp it up. every day in the U.S., there are murders. Every day in the U.S., there is robbery and sexual assault and a bunch of other terrible things. Ramp it up. Occasionally, there are mass shootings. There are also big, large-scale wars where millions of people die. God doesn't prevent all of this. God doesn't prevent any of the things that I just said, right? So if God does not prevent any of what I've said, because it happens, then it's pretty clear God does not prevent all evil. Some evil slips through the cracks, or God doesn't try. So, conclusion. God just doesn't exist. Okay. So we've looked at this argument. Now, the first thing we want to ask is, if the premises are all true at the same time, 1 through 5, then does the conclusion follow? Now, I've specifically designed this argument so that it follows a certain kind of logical form. Namely, it's a series of modus ponens or modus tollens in a complicated way to get you the conclusion. So the goal is to show that if you look at 2, 3, 4, and 5, then it's going to show that it is not the case. God is both omniscient, omnipotent, and omnibenevolent. But if you know that much, then you know, looking at premise 1, that's one of the things that's required, is that God has all three of those attributes for God to exist. And so if claim number one's right, then God just doesn't exist. Okay, so with that in view, it's a valid argument. It's a valid argument. If 1 through 5 are true, C has to be true. The conclusion follows from the premises. So then the question you want to ask is, are the premises all true? Are the premises all true? Okay. Now, the argument is designed to say that classical theism is just not true. To some extent, it's just saying that classical theism is not true. If God exists, it's not going to be one that has all three of those attributes. So if you hold to classical theism, this is basically saying you're wrong. Your God doesn't exist. So let's just assume, for the sake of argument, for it to get off the ground, that classical theism is true. That if God exists, then God has to have these attributes. If you deny that, then you're talking about like a different God than most of the major monotheistic religions are talking about then. You're going to be affirming some other kind of God. Okay, but then we'd want to kind of like go systematically through 2 through 5. So suppose 2 is false. You would basically want to say something like this. Even though God knows everything, God would not know about all evil and how to prevent all evil. That's basically how to deny premise 2, is you say, yeah, God knows everything, but there's a way for God to know everything that doesn't include knowing all the evil that exists and how to thwart it. You could just say, like, God's omniscience has certain kinds of limitations, like God can't know the future, so he can't know how to prevent evil. He would just know most of the time how to stop a lot of it, something like that. But that might not be strong enough to defend this argument, because then you would say, well, at least the stuff that God can predict he can stop, maybe that would count. Or maybe you just want to limit the kind of omniscience that God is said to have in other ways. Like maybe God doesn't know all details, but maybe he knows general facts of the universe, general facts about individual people. Well, then we're going to have to like think about what omniscience is and really narrow it down and restrict it from the way it's classically been understood. And that's a lot like saying one is false. So how could it be that God could know everything but not know about any and all evil and how to prevent it? That's a little hard to show. Suppose instead that you want to get rid of premise 3. Suppose you want to say that even if God's omnipotent, God can't prevent any and all evil. There's going to be some kinds of evil that God just can't prevent. There's some kinds of evil that God just is unable to prevent. Now, you might think that God, like, builds in limitations in himself so that, like, he could prevent stuff but chooses not to. But that wouldn't quite work with 3, because we're just trying to say that God has all ability, yet whatever this all ability is, this isn't like an ability that God like decides not to act on. We're talking about an ability, and that includes things like preventing evil and so on. So is there a way for God to have every ability possible available to him, yet there are some things that God can't prevent? It would look hard to come up with a good example of God being able to do whatever God wants, that nothing can stop God, and yet God is, for some things, unable to stop others. You'd have to figure out how that could be, how that would work. Most people probably want to get rid of 4. They want to show something like this, that even if God is all good, then it doesn't follow that God would choose to prevent any and all evil. There might be some reasons as a good God to allow evil. That might be a way to say that 4 is false, that you could have a God who's omnibenevolent but doesn't choose all the time to prevent all evil. What on earth could be a good enough reason, though? What could be a good enough reason? I suggest that you take this type of criticism of four to discussion, or in a paper, or ask me one-on-one. All of these are options for thinking about, like, a way to solve it. Most people think if they're going to solve this argument and say that God is omniscient, omnipotent, and omnibenevolent, that God can be good and not prevent it. But if that's true, what the heck would count as a good reason? Okay, for systematic sake, if somebody wanted to deny five, oh man, how would you do that? How would you deny that God does not prevent all evil? I tried to motivate it already, but maybe you just don't think evil exists. If that's right, you gotta account for something like what we mean by it, at least, when we say preventing evil or would want to get rid of evil. Even if you say that, like, evil is like a lack of something, like a hole is a lack of something. It's not a thing in the ground, it's a lack of ground. Or that sight isn't something. I'm sorry, that blindness isn't something, it's just a lack of sight. So it's missing sight. So some people might say that evil isn't a thing, it's a lack of good. It's a lack of something. So you could have good actions. If you lack the good, then it turns out to be an evil action. It's just deprived. It's deprived of its being good. In that case, you might say evil doesn't exist, but surely you should still be tempted by the idea that when we talk about evil, God would want to prevent it from being there. Just like you could prevent holes from being created or prevent people from getting blind, then you could prevent other kinds of evil or any other deprivation. If you want to show that five is false, it's going to be probably one of the hardest ones to show false.